We're back in Melbourne and the Commonwealth Games here on BBC One from One today. First, we've the Merseyside Derby to consider on Football Focus.
Good afternoon, welcome to Football Focus. It's Derby Day in Liverpool as teams jockey for position in the Premiership. They're officially the best Premiership team in 2006 so far. We hear from Everton's Tim Cahill on today's meeting on Merseyside. We've got a tale of two England strikers. As one aims to get even closer to the World Cup in the summer, the other is hoping just to be there. Across the water, a familiar face is making waves in the French league. The brains behind Bend It Like Beckham looks at the real work being done to encourage young Asian girls to play football. And Jurgen Klinsmann hits back at his critics as host Germany count down to the World Cup. And our three wise men today are Lee Sharp, Graeme, Saux and Mark Lawrenson. Well, today's 203rd Merseyside Derby has the makings of quite a spectacle. With Liverpool in goal-scoring mood, Everton head to Anfield as the best club in the league this year. David Moyes' side have won 7, drawn 2 and lost just one of their 10 Premiership matches in 2006. As Damian Johnson now reports, their successful run was prompted by defeat to Liverpool in December.
A 3-1 defeat, Liverpool's latest victims in a 9-match Premiership winning run and two men sent off. The last Merseyside derby in December was surely Everton's lowest point of the season.
A year that started so brightly has simply crumbled.
Their revival since then has been dramatic, due partly to Tim Cahill's welcome return to form.
It was definitely the lowest point in my time here, but the biggest thing that we understood is, like, you know, if you're going to play in the good times, you've got to learn to play in the bad times. And you know, I was there for when it was all going well, and I wanted to be there when it was going bad. So you just made sure you're playing every week so you could help make the turnaround. And finally, the new year, we turned around. We played 5 games in 2 weeks, and that's when I seemed to hit form and score 3 or 4 goals.
Let's talk about the three forward players, if you like, yourself, James McFadden and James Beattie. How does that all work?
I come from deep.
It's off the post, 2-0! Tim Cahill.
The Beats are starting to get involved more, holding the ball up. He's strong, he's powerful.
It's a lovely goal by James Beattie.
And Faddy's getting and nicking goals.
Alan Stubbs is back. What's he brought to the team?
He talks, he's strong, he knows exactly what he's doing. But, you know, we missed his moaning from the last time, so it was really good to have him back because he's a blue through and through, and we really need him for this week's game.
Let's talk about the Merseyside derby on Saturday. You owe them one. They turned you over pretty comfortably at Goodison earlier in the season.
Liverpool, very strong side, loads of depth, massive players and loads of money. You can't really compare two sides like that because we've got a lot of heart and a team who sticks together. But the biggest thing we need to do is just try and get at them. We need to stop them. I think the onus is on them being at home, not on us. We've hit some really good form, and I think they'll be wary of us more than what we're wary of them. As soon as we cross that white line, there'll be no respect for each other. It'll be all guns blazing, and, you know, hopefully we come off with a win.
Do the overseas players really get a sense of what it means to the locals here?
Yeah, definitely. You know, people always say to me, do you really know what this is? But this means everything. It's not just Saturday's game, it's Sunday, it's Monday, all the way through to the next derby, because these people breathe, eat and sleep football. The passion's really there, and it's in Liverpool you're either red or blue, and nothing else goes. So, you know, it's brilliant to be a part of this.
Can Everton get into Europe again?
We've changed the way people think of us. Everyone thought we had a chance of going down and really put us down. But we didn't really peak. We didn't show what we were made of, and we quietly progressed up. And now it's all about getting stronger. And now, yeah, I suppose this is where what we're looking for is with this win, hopefully against Liverpool this week, can escalate us up the table and go for Europe.
David Moyes this week linked with a move to Newcastle. Both clubs have instantly quashed the idea, but it's important you keep hold of him. He's a key to Everton's success.
Yeah, you know, what was it, 4 months ago, people were saying that he was ready to lose his job and things like that. It's ludicrous. And now, big club like Newcastle are interested, or speculation, but happens to everyone, managers, footballers and things like that. And he's Everton through and through, and you know, we're just really happy that all the rumours are squashed and we can just get on with concentrating on trying to get Everton up the table.
Well, Everton have moved up the table. They're ninth in the Premiership, 6 points behind Blackburn, who currently occupy that last European place. The question now is, Graeme, can they get into Europe?
Well, the run they're having, obviously they're top of the league table in terms of form, but I really feel that they're playing with the confidence that they have, a bit more of a swagger. Players like James Beattie are playing fantastically. Arteta in midfield, he's taken over from sort of the loss of Graveson, and they're building a confidence and momentum. I think they'll finish the season very strongly. They've got a good run in as well.
Three or four players have all found form. We'll talk about James Beattie in a second, but Tim Cahill, who we've heard from there, Lee, is one of them.
Without a doubt, yeah. And I think, you know, he's just said that he comes from deep. He's very hard to pick up and scores goals, and he's got a good celebration.
Yeah, I'm quite sure what it's all about. James Beattie, who you know, Graeme, from your days at Blackburn and Southampton.
Yeah, well, he used to clean my boots at Blackburn, and obviously he was in his prime at Southampton, so I used to clean his boots there. But no, he's a good player, he's a strong player. Suffered a little bit with his fitness, he had a few injuries, but he seems to have sort of overcome those now. He's had a consistent run in form. Because he's a big lad, he needs to play and train all the time, and the confidence he shows when he's in front of goal, when he's on form, is unbelievable. Some great goals.
Laura, what is going on with Liverpool? 15 goals in three games. It took them 16 games to get the previous 15 goals. How have they turned it around?
They've always made the chances. I think that's been the key. I don't think there's been very few games. Even the likes of Charlton at home, they made lots of chances. It was a 0-0. And all of a sudden, they've clicked. I mean, it doesn't mean to say that they solved the problem, because they still have a problem against the very best teams in the league in terms of scoring. And I think that will be addressed, obviously, in the summer months with players in. But They've played well all season, generally. Look at the number of games as well that they've played. But, you know, in terms of the derby, it's a long, long time since both teams have been playing so well at the same time, you know, when they go to play each other. So, at the very least, it should be a good game today.
Sure. Well, Liverpool will renew rivalries with Chelsea after being paired with the West Londoners for the fifth time this season in the semi-finals of the FA Cup. That game will be live on the BBC, incidentally, on Saturday, April the 22nd. The other tie sees either Borough or Charlton take on West Ham. Well, as Chelsea continue their pursuit of Cup and League honours, they received an unwanted double of their own this week from the FA. Dominic Cotton rounds up the last 7 days.
Apparently, Chelsea aren't playing according to their manager's plan. Perhaps that's why they're no longer invincible. Well, Jose Mourinho's team at least got the better of Newcastle in the FA Cup, John Terry's early goal putting them through to the last four. Before the end at Stamford Bridge, the actions of Sean Wright Phillips reopened the debate on diving. Robbie Elliott was sent off.
There's an element creeping into our game which I hate, and you're seeing more and more of it. I'd like to see referees not give fouls and to boot players for diving.
On Sunday, the champions were involved in more controversy. After flying in at Fulham, William Gallas was still surprised to be shown a red card. The Frenchman has since been let off with an FA warning for his gesture. Chelsea, meanwhile, face another charge of failing to control their players. They're refuting a similar allegation relating to their game at West Brom earlier this month. As if there wasn't enough for the authorities to be getting on with, they've had to launch an investigation into the post-match pitch invasion at Craven Cottage. One reason for the fans' over-exuberance was the result.
Oh, a chance of Fulham, Boamorte, Mal Brock. Oh, it's gone through Hurst's legs, Boamorte! And Fulham are ahead!
From the best result of the season for one team to the worst for another.
Peter Crouch makes it 3-0 Liverpool.
If Birmingham fans thought an FA Cup quarter-final with Liverpool was cause for excitement, they couldn't have been more wrong. In all, they conceded seven times, and calls for their manager to be sacked have intensified.
Unfortunately, today it was men against boys. We've got a nice couple of easy games with Man U and Chelsea on the horizon, so we've got to lift ourselves up. And, you know, tonight is one horror show.
After a goal drought, Liverpool are getting positively soaked. In their last three games, they've hit the target no less than 15 times. Peter Crouch got the first of their three at Newcastle in the league on Sunday. The Djibril Cisse penalty completed the scoring. He's since apologised for his rather over-the-top celebrations in front of the Newcastle fans. West Ham, who'd rested six players at the weekend, were clearly making their FA Cup quarter-final at Manchester City a priority. Well, it was a plan that paid off.
Here's Ashton. Ashton's done brilliantly to find space. Oh, what a goal that is! Dean Ashton for West Ham United.
The league hasn't brought Charlton or Middlesbrough much joy lately. Both suffered defeats at the weekend. Their FA Cup quarter-final ended goalless on Thursday. Mark Schwarzer keeping out the best Charlton chance of the night. Stuart Downing went close to nicking it for Borough in the second half, but the teams must replay on April the 12th to decide who'll take on West Ham in the semis. Kevin Ball's managerial baptism continues to be a tough one. His Sunderland team went down to a 24th league defeat of the season at Bolton. Kevin Nolan, the second player to breach their defence. Ball now needs to inspire his players to pick up seven more points. If he doesn't, they'll set a new lowest total for the English top division. West Brom's involvement in the relegation fight was further confirmed after their defeat at home to Manchester United. Louis Saha continued to take advantage of his run in the United starting lineup, the Frenchman scoring both of their goals. The form team at the bottom of the table are undoubtedly Portsmouth. Pedro Mendes scored the best of their four goals at West Ham. Harry really does now have a chance of pulling off a great escape.
We're in there scrapping there. We've closed the gap from 8 points a week ago with West Brom to 3 points now. Got a nice easy game next Saturday at the Gunners at home. So, you know, we'll get to prepare for that one.
Well, is Harry Houdini weaving that magic? Portsmouth are down there. They're level on points with Birmingham. It looks ever so tight, 3 points above them. A West Brom, can Harry do it, Lee?
You wouldn't bet against him, would you? And if it's experience that's required, then he's certainly got plenty of that. A great win the other day. And to take him on to the next game, they're going to be full of confidence. Birmingham have just been beat 7. So they're not going to exactly be going into the next game all guns blazing. So I think, you know, watch this space. I'm sure Harry can do it again.
Do you agree, Laura?
If you look at the fixtures, it's probably more winnable, if that's the right word, than the likes of Birmingham, West Brom's fixtures. Big game against Arsenal today. I think they can go close. I wouldn't be as convinced as they've been in former years in terms of getting clear, but it depends how much confidence they've taken from those two wins, really.
Sure. And Graeme, we mentioned the unwanted double for Chelsea. It's a second charge from the FA. Is this unlucky from Chelsea that they've been... found guilty here, well, not found guilty, but being charged, or is this a serious case of indiscipline?
Well, I think there's been a growing sort of sense that things are going on surrounding referees, intimidating referees. It's become sort of quite popular, and it's up to the FA to show consistency by charging all clubs with the same sort of punishment for that action. So it's important, it's really important that if Chelsea are charged with something and are found guilty of it, that the same rules apply to other clubs, because Chelsea, I think, at the moment, especially with that Fulham game, feel a little bit hard done by, because the Fulham fans surrounded the ref on the handball incident with Drogba.
I think in the summer there are many issues for the FA to deal with, and there's that issue. There's people asking for other players to be booked. We saw it last week. George Boateng was asking for Savage to be booked, and he was, and he was sent off. And I think there's a diving issue. I think we're going to have a really busy summer, and we've got the World Cup as well. Did you know that?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. Well, we saw a bit of Newcastle there. That game was Alan Shearer's last chance at winning a medal in his 10 years there, but he hasn't got any regrets.
No, that's life. You work very hard. Sometimes you get what you deserve, sometimes you don't. I don't deserve anything more than anyone else that works hard in this game. I give it my best shot. I think I've got 8 or 9 games left of my career, and I'll enjoy them.
One medal for Alan Shearer in an illustrious career, individually that is, Lauro. It doesn't do him justice, really.
No, it doesn't do him justice. And of course, he's been at Newcastle all those years where they seem to have changed the managers like their underpants, haven't they? That's been the great problem. There's been no great stability. And, of course, well documented, he could have gone and played for Manchester United and he would have an absolute potful. But he has other fantastic memories and he's been brilliant. Arguably the best player for me in the Premiership.
OK. Well, talking of the FA Cup, we'll have live coverage of the quarter-final replay involving Borough and Charlton from the Riverside. That tie takes place on the 12th of April. We start on BBC One at 8 o'clock. OK, let's take a look at this afternoon's games in the Barclays Premiership. Under pressure, David O'Leary sees his Aston Villa side take on Fulham. The West Londoners are the only league club in England still without an away win. Two sides with contrasting fortunes in the FA Cup in midweek meet at Stamford Bridge as Chelsea host Manchester City. Elsewhere, it's Sunderland-Blackburn at the Stadium of Light. Blackburn without Robbie Savage after his first red card in club football last week. And at the JJB, Wigan face FA Cup semi-finalist West Ham. Wayne Rooney got a closer look at the trophy he'll be hoping to lift in Germany in July when he posed with the Real World Cup in London this week. An audience of competition winners welcomed the England striker who flew in from Manchester in the company of Ray Stubbs.
Not really. I'm not too bad on the big planes, but on the likes of this plane, it's a bit scary, a bit bumpy.
How do you amuse yourself on a flight like this with Manchester United or England? How do you pass the time?
Myself, a lot of players have iPods and laptops, and we play a bit of cards as well.
What's your favourite tune at the moment?
I love the Stereophonics. I think they're my favourite band. Oasis, Travis, like all music like that. And, you know, I like more or less any music, to be honest with you. But I think the Stereophonics is definitely my favourite band. So have a nice day. Have a nice
day. Have a nice day. Have a nice day.
It must be difficult not to get noticed nowadays.
Yeah, it is, and you know, when you're walking through town or when you're doing anything, you know, it's like it comes to a standstill, you know, you know everyone's looking at you and you're just trying to keep looking ahead and keep walking.
Now we're down in the capital on the way to the venue. Are you excited about being close to the World Cup trophy or is it a bit of metal?
No, yeah, obviously I'm excited, you know, it's the World Cup's the biggest tournament in the world and it's good company, you know, obviously seeing the World Cup.
What are your earliest World Cup memories and where were you?
98 was probably like when I really, really watched it properly, you know, especially Michael Owen's first tournament and, you know, it was when he scored against Argentina, it was brilliant, brilliant goal. And I was just in my nan's watching it and went and played the football out in the street after.
So you watched Michael score that goal then went straight outside and started practising it even more?
Yeah, no, it's after, you know, we used to go out and, you know, we used to all say what players were and I used to say I was him. So, you know, it's good now that I'm lucky enough to partner with my friend.
An opportunity this afternoon to get to know him a little better, we think. We already know that on a football pitch he can do very special things. Ladies and gentlemen, Wayne Rooney. Are you into that sort of the science of it now more to make the best of yourself as a professional?
Not really. I think we just do a lot more running and things like that, you know. I've never touched a weight in my life.
Don't go near the weights now?
No, I get paid to play football, not be a weightlifter.
Yeah. Last film you watched, last DVD you bought?
Cinderella Man was the last one I watched. And
any good?
Yeah, it was good, it was really good. I watched it with my girlfriend and, you know, there was a few tissues coming out at the end.
You're crying over films.
It's getting too honest now, isn't it? It's getting too honest.
No, I think, you know, I'm the same as everyone else. I'm a normal lad and, you know, it was a bit sad at the end.
Ladies and gentlemen, Wayne Rooney. What was it like being so close to the World Cup? Was it what you expected?
No, it was a lot bigger than what I expected. And, you know, it's a great trophy.
You didn't want to touch it today. I don't think many people are allowed to touch it, but that would be tempting fate.
Yeah, no, I didn't want to. You know, I think it's only right if you'd only touch it if you win it. So, you know, hopefully that will come.
Hopefully. Laura, it's nice to see the other side to Wayne Rooney.
Yeah, well, as you know, I got a lift back on the plane.
Yeah, you were there,
so
yeah.
I spent a bit of time with him. But, you know, it's amazing when you think that, like, that the whole country is resting on his shoulders in many, many ways. And for such a young lad. But he's matured. I think, you know, it's undoubted about it. And he's just a nice lad who happens to be an extremely gifted footballer, which is fantastic for him.
Interesting how he talks about watching the Argentina game with Michael Owen when he was a kid and went out to impersonate him. Footballers have their own footballing idols.
Well, yeah, I mean, when we all grew up loving football, you impersonate the big players of your generation that you watch. And it's only natural that he always wanted to be a footballer. So he was always going to carry on sort of and watch something like the World Cup, see Michael Owen and want to be like him. And look what he's achieved. I mean, it's incredible.
I don't think he would have ever admitted to that if he'd still been playing for Everton, though.
No, that's a good point.
He celebrated when Michael Owen scored and pretended to be like him.
And Michael Owen reports in all of today's papers, Lee, about how his recovery from injury has now been set back by 2 weeks after a minor op on his foot yesterday. Newcastle obviously are playing this down. Should we be worried?
Yeah, I think we should be. I think he's a major asset and a major force for England. Mm. I know they've said it's a minor operation, it's only putting back 2 weeks, but, you know, we're sort of middle of March now, and that means he can't train for another couple of weeks, and whether he's going to be fully fit and you know, fired and ready to go for the World Cup, we'll have to wait and see.
He's got a screw loose, isn't he?
Yeah.
Well, that's literally...
Yeah, that's exactly right, yeah. They just tightened it.
Yeah, well, there you go.
And you'll be able to see highlights of Rooney in action for Manchester United tomorrow, Match of the Day 2 with Ray. We'll also have the best of Charlton v Newcastle and Borough against Bolton. 10:30, BBC Two. Now, after a six-year reign at Liverpool, Gerard Houllier has been rebuilding his reputation in his native France, with his Lyon side on course for a fifth successive league title. But their sights are also on European glory. Next week, they face Milan in the last eight of the Champions League, hoping to emulate Liverpool's success last season.
It's a long way from Liverpool to Lyon. That's the journey that Gerard Houllier has made to revive his career after the end of his reign at Anfield. But it seems you can take the man out of Merseyside, you can't take Merseyside out of the man.
When Liverpool won the Champions League, I know you went into the dressing room afterwards to see the players. Yeah. What was that like?
Special. I won't say more than that. Special, particularly with some of the players.
Do you regret that perhaps you hadn't been...
No, I had no regrets, no. And when people ask me... what contribution was yours to that? I said, none. It's just the players and Rafael Benitez.
Can you tell us how the conversation went with some of the players?
No, I'll keep that secret. But I must say that the staff and Rafael himself and Rick Parry and Dave Moore, they were fantastic, really.
It was an emotional...
I always privileged my relationship with the people in Liverpool.
It was an emotional night in Istanbul. Were you emotional?
Yeah, it was. I mean, I was extremely happy that they won.
Will part of you always be a Liverpool fan?
You can't live 6 years with a club and with the way we've been through. I mean, the reconstructing of some elements of the club. And don't get me wrong, I'm not, you know, delivering any message against the people before. So you can't live 6 years there, have the success, have the relationship that we have with the people, and not be a supporter. I was a fan before I came to Liverpool, and I mean, the first result I looked at is, of course, the Liverpool result.
What are your thoughts now about facing AC Milan in the next round?
Milan, for the last four Champions League, won once. I think it was in Manchester against Juventus, and played the final against Liverpool last season. And it's unfortunate that our best player won't be playing for the first leg. But, you know, sometimes you have to do without your best player if you want to win things.
You mentioned Janinho. I presume that's who you're talking about.
Yeah.
He's been a revelation at free kicks particularly, but also an important
part of the team. No, he's not only a free kick taker. I mean, obviously, because he scores very important free kicks for us, but and also sometimes indirect free kicks. But he's a very good midfield player, and he gives some kind of fluidity and fluency in the game that, you know, which is very useful. Yeah.
People say it's a side without stars. Is that the way you see it?
Well, they're not known stars for England, but they're known stars, you know, somewhere else.
Allonge, allez, Vieira face à face avec Peter Schmeichel. Winter et but. But de Silva Winter.
It's a team which is very competitive, and it's a team which is mentally extremely strong.
Would you ever be tempted to go back and work in England again?
Of course, yeah.
You miss it?
I do, yeah.
That smile says it all, doesn't it? He's done brilliantly at Lyon, yeah. I mean, despite losing Michael Essien in the summer.
Well, you know, I think he would be one of the first to say, being an honest man, that he inherited a lot of good players. Mm. As I say, this could be the fifth successive title for them as well. Paul Le Guin, the guy who's gone to Rangers, has done a fantastic job. Like Remy Gard used to play for Arsenal. They tell me he's a very, very good coach. But Gerrard's done well. I think they'll beat AC Milan. I think I've seen Lyon about four or five times this season. I think they're a very good team. All right, Janinho misses the first game, but I think it's an AC Milan team that's ageing. And I'm not surprised that he wants to come back and manage in the Premiership. I think he misses that day-to-day sort of cut and thrust, which I don't think you get in many other leagues.
There's no doubt they've got exciting players, haven't they? Sylvain Wiltord, ex-Arsenal, Janinho.
Oh, no, they're very talented players, but I think he said it in the piece there that it's a team, it's a well-built team. He's, you know, they're well-coached, well-disciplined, and enjoying a huge sort of success through their consistency.
A little earlier, we heard from one England striker hoping to fulfil a nation's World Cup dream. Now to another who's doing his best just to make it to Germany. Tottenham striker Jermaine Defoe has been speaking to Ivan Gaskell.
Just 23, already a role model for a new generation. The launch of the Barclays Premiership Skill Factor CD, another reminder of football's huge appeal.
I think in this country, you know, it's football's, you know, it's massive. When you drive around in your car, you know, you look in parks and things like that, you know, you always see kids playing around playing football. So it means a lot to them, and I think it means a lot to me as well. So yeah, I've really enjoyed it. It's good.
Did you learn any new skills with that game down there as well?
I try to, you know, a little bit stiff, but yeah, I try to.
The Spurs' skill factor's been pretty high this season too. On the verge of their best ever Premiership finish, after years of failed experiments, they seem to have got the chemistry right.
You know, it's been a great season for everyone at the club. Obviously, we just want to keep it going now. You know, there's not a lot of games left. I think if we keep it going, keep working hard, keep the team spirit, then, you know, I think we can achieve something special. I think we've realised now that every game we play is almost like a cup final. We need the points, and everyone knows that. So, when we go out there, even when we got a goal down, we still believe that we can win the game.
On a personal level, Defoe suffered frustration. He's had to bite his lip on the subs bench for almost half a season.
It's been difficult, but you know, I just keep working hard. You know, keep doing what I'm doing in training, and when I do get a chance, you know, make sure that I take it. And it's been up and down, but you know, at the same time, I've really enjoyed this season. My family's helped me. I've got good people around me. So you know, after games, I always go to my mum's house. You know, obviously I've got my mum, my little sister, my dad, agent, girlfriend. You know, I've got good people around me. So after the games, when I'm done, they're sort of like, they pick me up. So I'm quite lucky in that way, yeah.
There are implications, I guess, for England. I hate to raise this subject so close to the World Cup. But 6 months ago, I guess people would have seen you as a shoo-in for the World Cup in Germany.
I think so,
Now
yeah.
People are not quite so sure. I mean, is that on your mind and how much?
Yeah, it's been on my mind, to be honest. I think it's only normal. And if I'm not playing, then obviously people are going to say, well, he's not playing, why should he go? Or whatever. But at the same time, I think a lot of people that are saying that, they know what I can do. They've seen what I can do for a number of years. And I'll just wait. You know, once I'm playing and I'm scoring goals, then you know, hopefully the manager will realise that I'm the right person to go.
Is it you or Darren Bent, do you think?
I don't know. It's hard. Bent is my mate at the end of the day. You know, he's done well this season. But I'm the type of person, I always look for myself, you know, always trying to improve my game, and don't really think about anyone else. I think I just want to improve my game and just keep working hard for myself and make sure I'm there.
Have you considered what the summer might be like for you if you don't go to Germany?
I couldn't imagine. It'd be horrible. Obviously, it's something that I've looked forward to for a long time. you know, I'm only 23. To go to a World Cup now, you know, it'd be great. When I walk on the street and things like that, and I talk to people, and they would say to me, oh, good luck in Germany, and things like that, and that means a lot. So obviously people saying good luck, like you should be going. So obviously it means a lot, but at the same time, I've got to do it myself. I've got to get there, and I've got to produce, so, yeah.
Well, Jermaine Defoe, it seems, is the innocent party in this war of words now between Spurs and Liverpool. Mm. Rafael Benitez saying yesterday that Spurs are desperate to sell the player.
Yeah.
I want to get your views on that, Laura, but we've got an email here from Derek Laker who says, Benitez is bang out of order in saying that Spurs want rid of Jermaine Defoe. It's obvious what he's trying to do. He wants the archetypal front line for Liverpool in Crouch and Defoe. This is a very dirty and underhand thing for Benitez to do.
I think it's a bit of a storm in a teacup, and I'd like to know what the role the agents have played in it. But it happens every day in football nowadays, if you want someone else's player, just the way that it is. I think Benitez has also come back this morning saying, hold on a minute, Tottenham have been trying to sell him for ages. I think by tomorrow morning when something else breaks, it'll have gone. It will have gone away. But you'd have to say well done to Jermaine Defoe, because he's just kept at it. Not really started many games. Robbie Keane's sort of taken over his partnership with Mido. But he's just kept at it. He knows it's World Cup year. I think he'll go.
Yeah.
And, of course, as we discussed before about Owen being put back 2 or 3 weeks, I think he'll definitely be in the squad.
It's so frustrating because he's, you know, it's out of his control slightly. You know, you can't pick yourself in the team. Mm. And it's, you know, to train knowing you're not going to play, it's got to be so frustrating, especially in a World Cup year.
And also not to go knock on the manager's door saying, you know, why am I not playing? So I think he's done well.
Well, his manager, Martignol, has already said Defoe shouldn't be worried about his World Cup place.
Because he's not going.
Because he is going, or he should be going. Do you agree with that, then, Lee? He should be going.
Yeah, I think he should be going. I'd definitely take him. I think he had something a little bit extra. And in tight games, he can come on, last 15, 20 minutes and make something out of nothing and score some good goals.
OK. Now, you may remember the film Bend It Like Beckham, which tells a story of a young Asian girl defying cultural barriers to play football. Well, this week, the director of the movie, Gurinder Chadha, paid a visit to a real-life group of girls taking part in West Ham's Asians in Football scheme in London's Tower Hamlets.
In one of the most deprived areas of the country, a group of girls make a 15-minute journey in the rain to play football. You think it sounds like a film? Or you're mistaken. This is the East End of London, and it's for real. My first impression is the enthusiasm that these young girls are playing with, an enthusiasm that is matched by project manager Mick King.
You want myself, Del and Graeme to show you how to do that?
Yes!
Mick's main goal is to bring the disparate community together through football, and it seems to be working. This session alone brings together Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims and Catholics.
I think you can see for yourself that these girls have not been playing long, dispel an awful lot of stereotypes and myths that not just Asian kids, but Asian girls. And I think they're learning, they're responding, their movement work, their balance, their technical work is good. What they're doing in games tactically is very good. So we're really pleased with them.
Part of the reason the girls seem to be so motivated is the attitude of the coaches involved, such as Dell, who is well aware of the job in hand.
The dominant culture in this bar, right, is Bangladeshi Muslim. So, you know, not being Bangladeshi Muslim, some have said, you know, oh, you're different, it's a bit of a struggle, but not really. Like I said, you just need to make sure you've got that right relationship with the teachers and the schools and the kids, and they'll feed off enthusiasm.
So you're a bit of a role model then here for them?
Well, that is what I want to be, yeah, a positive role model.
I get as much pleasure from working with Dell to have an impact in his community as a local lad. He's a Sikh guy working in a predominantly Bengali setting, and I think that's a great piece of interaction and a great piece of integration. So when kids and people from communities integrate, I'm happy, and I'm lucky that we can use football to do that, because I love football as well.
The girls themselves are all too aware of the benefits of getting out and playing sport, in particular football.
We encourage each other, and the coaches, they're really good, they help us.
It's really fun and you learn a lot of things.
You don't just work with your own religion, you work with other religions.
We enjoy playing football out here.
And some of these kids are going to grow up to be young adults soon, quicker than we realise.
Yeah.
And it won't be alien to them, the notion of their sons and daughters playing football in the way perhaps it were to previous generations.
It's not just one type of culture that's good at football. Everyone can be good at football.
Do you think that Beckham had, and it meant it like Beckham had an impact on this?
When we spoke about today's topic, they all understand that playing on the wing is Beckham's position. The fact that it was a young Asian girl that came through it, I think, also served as a role model.
The scheme shouldn't be judged on how many superstars it produces. Rather, it's the fun, confidence and opportunity it's giving these girls. That's what makes it a success.
Are you better at playing football than your dad?
Probably.
I can direct the movie, but I can't play.
I can't. Come on, walk the walk.
Thanks to Grinda for that report. Great work being done by West Ham. They're helped with funding from the Football Foundation. And a reminder, we've got live international football for you tomorrow as England's women look to keep up their 100% record in World Cup qualifying.
That sure is, Marcus.
Sit down.
So what are you looking forward to on Mother's Day then?
The best thing about Mother's Day, having a lie-in.
Take it easy, get pampered a bit.
Put my feet up.
Play for England, of course.
Yeah, World Cup qualifier.
Massive game.
Crunching tackles, great goals. What would be the best present you could get then?
Oh, chocolates or flowers.
Bottle of wine.
Or 3 points against France.
That'll keep us top of the table.
That means 1 foot in the finals if we win that.
That'd be quality. World Cup in China.
You don't really want chocolates and flowers, do you?
To Scotland now, and Celtic are just 2 games away from taking the SPL title. They're 17 points ahead of Hearts, and manager Gordon Strachan is aiming to add to his first trophy, which he won last weekend. Goals from Magic Zarowski, Sean Maloney and Dion Dublin here wrapped up a comfortable 3-0 win over Dunfermline in the CIS Cup final. The victory was dedicated to the former Celtic legend Jimmy Johnston, who died earlier in the week. Meanwhile, in the SPL today, Aberdeen take on a Motherwell side unbeaten in 3 games. Kilmarnock, who secured a top six finish, travel to Dundee United. Falkirk, without a win at home in the league this season, entertain Hearts. It's Hibs v Inverness Cali Thistle at Easter Road. And at Ibrox, Rangers take on Dunfermline. And Gretna could secure successive promotions today if they beat Alloa in the second division. While the soap opera at Tynecastle goes on, this week coach Graeme Ricks was sacked, leaving the club looking for their fourth manager in 10 months. Well, this was winger Paul Hartley's reaction to yet another managerial change.
We thought that the manager would have been here at the end of the season to see hopefully that we're going to have success. But Valdez has come in, he's not new to the players, he's been here since August, so he knows what we're about. We know he's took a lot of training sessions before, so there's nothing new to us.
Well, what is going on at Hearts, Laura?
I think they'll get the manager that they deserve soon. No one.
Really?
Well, 4 managers in 10 months, it's nuts. It's absolutely crazy. I mean, what do they expect to get?
There's obviously an agenda there, isn't there?
No.
Hidden agenda.
What is mind-boggling is they're obviously aiming for second place. Credit has got to go to the players for keeping the continuity going.
Listen,
but they're gambling for £10 million Champions League money here.
They could finish second, which it looks like they're going to, and they could win the Scottish Cup final and sacking managers. Right.
Yes. On that baffling note, we'll leave that one there. Well, after leading the chasing pack for what seems like months now, Reading could be celebrating promotion to the Premiership today if, it's a big if, Steve Coppell's men beat Leicester City. It would also be an English league record for the earliest post-war promotion. Well, Roger Johnson is at the Walker Stadium. Hi, Roger.
Hi, Manisha. The atmosphere is just about starting to build here. What, 2.25 hours before kick-off? The first Reading fans starting to arrive, as you say. The first time in their club's 135-year history that they'll have played in the top flight of English football when this promotion is confirmed. It could be today, as you rightly say, it probably will. And supporters starting to come from all different parts of the country to support their team today on what they are pretty sure is an inevitable move to the Premiership. Let's talk to the Wakefields here from Bracknell. Mrs. Wakefield, first of all, big day for your club.
Oh, very big. Best day in the world.
Is it the biggest day you think that Reading has ever had? It's got to be.
Yes, definitely. I'm really looking forward to it.
And why do you think they've done so well?
Oh, great players, great team. They've been really bonding really well together. And they've really gelled. And there's been no selfish players this season at all.
OK,
the booths from Wokingham are here as well. No star players, though.
No, it's been fantastic, and I think the team spirit is one of the things that's been really fantastic this season. No star players, they've really gelled together and played fantastic football.
And Steve Coppell, all season he said, we're not looking at the league table, we're not thinking about promotion, but today surely he's got to be.
Well, all season he's just stuck by his words, and now today, promotion.
Excellent. These fine folk are from down on the south coast at Folkestone. Do you get a bit of stick for being a Reading fan down there?
Yeah, all my mates have supported Premiership clubs, and I've stuck by Reading all the way. Always Gloria get stick up.
But you see, you'll be in the Premiership next season now, won't you, all being well?
Yeah, 6 points off them, aren't we?
Excellent. And Dad at the back, you've followed the Royals for many years, from Elm Park now to a stadium at the Medeski, which is fit for the Premiership.
Of course it is, yeah. And it's about time. It's about time. We've got the best team we've ever had, and our team. No superstars, and Nicky Shorey for England. Tell you that now. Best left back outside the Premiership.
Now, Reading in the Premiership, that's almost certain. Nicky Shorey for England. I think that might be stretching credibility just a little bit too much. Manish, back to you.
Thanks, Roger. They're all nodding in the studio to that one. And you can find out whether Reading can secure promotion to the top flight for the first time in 135 years on Score.
Welcome to Score.
Fantastic goal.
What's that called? He's not listening to me.
Let me finish.
Volatile at times, to say the least.
Arsene Wenger said that, so it must be true.
Answer the question!
I'm not even kidding.
Can I be your assistant?
All the knowledge is there.
They've got good characters.
Flash your hot dog, or in my case, three or four.
Gavin, you look like your dad.
So for the latest on all of today's league games, press the red button from 2:30. Time to turn our attentions to the World Cup. This week, the focus spotlight falls on the coach of host nation Germany, Jurgen Klinsmann, who's come under increasing pressure in the build-up to the tournament. Well, 40 years on from England's World Cup victory over West Germany, members of both squads are reunited this week as Franz Beckenbauer and teammates flew into London. Beckenbauer, chairman of the organising committee for this year's World Cup, recently criticised Klinsmann for failing to attend a World Cup workshop and opting instead to return to his home in California just a fortnight after his side were hammered 4-1 in Italy. The pressure eased slightly this week as the Germans beat an understrength US side 4-1 in Dortmund, but with just 76 days until the start of the tournament, Jonathan Pearce caught up with Jürgen in Germany.
Jürgen, it's 32 years since Germany last hosted a World Cup. 32 years of expectancy and the pressure that goes along with that have built up. How are you dealing with that pressure?
Well, pressure is always there. You know, once you take over a job like that, it's a huge responsibility, but it's also a huge honor. Then you will always face pressure, and in a football country like Germany, with the history we have, you know, the expectations are always the highest. And we knew that from the beginning on, and we always said that, you know, we will go through up and downs by rebuilding a new team, and that's what we did. We brought in a new generation of players, and we developed a style of play that is attacking oriented, that has also parts of risks in it. And so we knew things will go better here and then, and things will go not that good. Certainly it's not nice if you lose a friendly in Italy 4-1 by 3 goals. You know, that's no big pleasure. But that happens in football, and that's part of it. And we are very, very confident once we have the team then together in the middle of May for almost 3.5 weeks to really build the right spirit in those 3.5 weeks to go into a World Cup full of confidence and full of enthusiasm and to play a good World Cup.
Is the German FA wholly united behind you? Because in England we hear stories that the great Franz Beckenbauer has said this about Jurgen Klinsmann, has said that about Jurgen Klinsmann.
Well, they would like to prolong my contract, so the Federation in terms is behind us for sure. There are always comments in the media because the way the media world works right now in Germany, there's always discussion. They get always asked, if I do one thing, they ask the next day 18 Bundesliga coaches what they think about it. Then they find one at the wrong time, you know, and he maybe makes a critical comment, so then they will blow up this one comment as the big story, not saying that actually 17 other coaches are totally behind what we are doing. The people, the fans, they believe in that team. After losing against Italy and getting all this criticism from the media, wherever I went over the last week, people came up and clapped myself on the shoulder and said, Jürgen, just please don't change your path. You know, please don't let them bother you, because we know where you want to end up at the end of the day. We always try to put ourselves down before a big event comes up. You know, we are very pessimistic, we are very negative, but actually inside there's a huge hope, meaning, well, then the thing will turn out completely different, you know, and by winning then the first game, or the first two games, suddenly we turn from a totally pessimistic point of view into a positive hype.
During the build-up, you've decided to base yourself away from Germany, back home in America. Has that been a hindrance?
No, it's a huge advantage, even if some traditional people obviously have the opposite opinion. It helped me a lot. It helped me a lot always to look at things from outside the box. It helped me a lot to change many things in the environment of the national team. I won't please everybody. You know, it's not my job to do it right to everybody. My job is it to build a successful German team. And by knowing it, that when you go through a transition like we are going right now, bringing in a lot of young players, a lot of young blood into that team, you walk on a fine line. But in order to be really successful at that World Cup this summer, we need to walk on a fine line, and we'll give it a shot.
Does that win over the United States for Germany, does it encourage the public? I mean, does it make it all better again, or does it paper over the cracks?
It doesn't make it all better because they got beat 4 by Italy, but it certainly helps. But could you imagine if all of a sudden the manager of England, Sven, was going back to Sweden every time and sort of orchestrating the whole World Cup campaign from there, being the host nation? So you can imagine, I mean, we've just started to go World Cup mad here. Over there, those being Germany being the host nation is even worse, of course, in terms of the microscope. And he lives in America, but as he says, it helps him deal with all sorts of things. He's away from Germany, helps him prepare. I would never underestimate the Germans, as we know, and also the fact that they're at home make a big difference. And by the way, they've got the easiest group of all the other 8 groups.
They have. Well, Richard from London, looking at this group, says, forget the poor build-ups, Germany will make it through to the semi-finals, at least in the World Cup. It's Germany. They always do well when it counts. Well, when we look at the group like that, they'll be doing well, or, you know, they'll be doing badly not to do well.
Listen,
in that group.
If they don't get through that group, we'll be back in a boat to the US in a lower plane. Don't worry. Slow boat.
I mean, the thing is, you've got this, you know, the fact that if they can get through these games, which they should, the feel-good factor from that will generate sort of an intensity in Germany, and they'll feel that they can, you know, can go all the way. And they're great at tournament football. They've always done well. They got battered by England 5-1 and still did well in that sort of championship. You know, they'll do well as a team.
Finally, Lee, Klinsmann's got a difficult choice to make as goalkeepers go. Does he go for Oliver Kahn or Jens Lehmann?
I would have thought he'll probably stick with Oliver Kahn. It is a tough choice, but I think experience, and it will be Oliver Kahn's last World Cup, so I'm sure he'll want to put on a good performance.
OK. Well, that's it from us. Thanks as ever to Lee, Graeme and Mark. Press a red button for Score from 2:30. You won't miss a goal from today's league games. We leave you with a special project between Manchester City and A Question of Sport, where teenagers are learning about the benefits of keeping healthy.
You're at the football training ground, so we're going to treat you like footballers today. What we're doing at the moment with Best, A Question of Sport, we've been using football as a motivational tool, like a vehicle really, to improve things such as health, fitness, lifestyle, and also things with diet literacy. And we're going to get the kids to talk about it, we're going to get them to make video diaries about it, and at the same time learn what it's like to be a top footballer.
I'm going to talk a little bit to you now about the other side of the football game. Whatever lifestyle you lead, diet is a massive thing. We try and tell our young players at the football club to have a well-balanced diet. Go! You might be a little bit low on energy, what could you have?
Let's play!
A glass of orange juice would class as one piece of fruit.
I'm delighted to introduce two of our finest youngsters, Stephen Ireland and Mika Richards.
Which team did you support growing up?
Just Arsenal, because of Ian Wright, I just thought he was a quality player.
I supported Manchester United, but as soon as I came here, that all changed.
Do all the players get a good feeling and buzz before a match?
You have to, like, you have to go and perform, so everyone gets psyched up really good, yeah?
Yeah, brings a bit of luck.